this.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Hero Movie Podcast, your greatest source for superhero movie discussion in the multiverse. I am your host, Adam Portrais, and I'm joined by Sean King.
Heidi thinks that green mask is crazy looking.
And of course, Bruce Leslie.
I'm a prickly pear. Smoking, somebody stop me, I don't know.
No one is here to stop us, ladies and gentlemen, because we have come together to do what our Patreon people have told us to do. So over here at Hero Movie Podcast, we usually review new or older, superhero movies of one sort or another, sometimes some television programs. But every now and then, we like to have our people over at patreon.com/HMP tell us what to do. Because you know what? You guys are our bosses, and we'll do what you say, man. So we put it up for a vote, and you guys, with a pretty decent margin here, chose The Mask from 1994 starring Jim Carrey. And that's what we're going to be reviewing today. Whether you guys did good or bad, we'll see in a little bit. But hey, it's not like they've ever done us wrong before, right, guys?
Oh, never.
Never. No, it's always been the toppest of top notch. So
I think most of the voting is just done by what is going to make Sean angry. Let's do that.
Listen, you know, you show all the cards, man. They're going to just go like, oh, all in. Every time. So it is what it is, man. But not only do we enjoy the people that go to patreon.com/HMP who get to vote on the show, who get the pre-show and post-show and all that kind of good stuff, we also enjoy the people that go over to the iTunes and drop us a 5-star review. It's been quite some time. 5 stars, a.k.a. a humdinger.
Humdinger.
Ooh, I have missed that, man. It's been a while. This one comes to us from Apple Scruff 909. I like it.
My favorite kind of scruff.
I think I know Apple Scruff, but continue, please.
And it's entitled, The Name's Dinger. Humdinger. This is the one. This is the podcast that I most eagerly await every week and am excited about when it drops because I can't wait to spend some more time with these goofballs. Listening to Adam, Sean, and Bruce, and sometimes Matt, is nothing short of delightful. Their knowledgeability, I guess that's a word, good humor, quick wit, and chemistry with one another make it one of the most pleasant, informative, and hilarious podcasts in my library. I defy anyone to find another podcast team that works better with one another than these folks do. Maybe other people have put it to words better than I could, but bottom line is I'm rather fond of these gents and the hard work they do, and am happy to contribute what I can to their Patreon funds. I encourage you all to do so as well, and that's from AppleScruff909. See, it's people like that that come down, give us a 5-star review, a.k.a. Humdinger.
Humdinger.
That help this show keep on keeping on, man. It's AppleScruff909. Thank you so much for that review. And guess what? You, too, can review us. Just drop on down to the iTunes there. And, hey, man, if you're not on iTunes, I completely understand that. Go tell a friend. Tell a buddy. Just say, look, I know you're a nerd because nerds hang out with nerds, don't you? We all do.
Take out advertising in the New York Times.
Yeah, whatever it takes, man. I don't want excuses. I just want listeners.
Which reminds me, guys, we need to start talking more post-show about the blimp idea.
Oh, the blimp idea. That's, listen.
Yeah.
Dirigibles are the wave of the future.
That's what I have been saying. Now, we did get a couple of emails, but we're going to save those for next week, and we'll talk about why a little bit towards the end of the show. But as we said, the people that go to patreon.com/HMP have voted, and their almost unanimous choice, at least 50-50, was for us to review The Mask. So here is the trailer for The Mask from 1994.
This is the story of Stanley Ipkiss.
Stanley, you are the nicest guy. Really, you are.
Yeah. His job is at the bank.
You're 40 minutes late. Now that's the same as stealing.
I'm sorry, Mr. Dickey. It'll never happen again.
He loves his dog.
Come on, give him to me. Drop it.
He's polite to his landlord.
Ipkiss, do you have any idea what time it is?
You know, Mrs. Peenman.
What?
Nothing.
And the most exciting thing in his life are his pajamas. But now...
Hey, you! What are you doing down there?
I'm just looking for my mask!
All that is about to change. Because Stanley Ipkiss is not the man he used to be.
Smokin'!
It's like it brings your innermost desires to life. You become some sort of a love-crazy wild man.
I want him here tomorrow, alive.
Now you have to ask yourself one question. Do I feel lucky? Do ya? Bunks?
Jim Carrey is...
That's the guy!
Hello!
The Mask.
Ooh, somebody stop me!
Alrighty, that is the trailer for The Mask from 1994. Here's the IMDb plotline. As we know, IMDb always 100% correct in everything they say and or do. Bank clerk Stanley Ipkiss is transformed into a maniac superhero when he wears a mysterious mask. Good job there. It was directed by Chuck Russell. I think his real name is Charles, though. That's just me, and that's just a guess. Starring Jim Carrey, Cameron Diaz, Peter Reinhardt, Peter Green, Amy Yazbek, and Richard Jenny. And maybe one or two other people that we'll come across. But first things first here is we have to ask ourselves one of the more important questions here. That's a little bit low. I don't know why, because my computer's being funny. But hey, Bruce, what do you got for us?
Well, The Mask was created by writer Mike Richardson, published by Dark Horse Comics, beginning in 1987. Oh, and in case you didn't know, in 1986, he founded Dark Horse Comics. That's one way to get your comic published, isn't it? He's also the founder and president of Things from Another World, a cool chain of comic shops. And of course, I'm most familiar with the Portland, Oregon location. Now, according to Wikipedia, he owns a landscaping company that nets $2.75 million a year in Amherst, New York. And I swear this is a direct quote from Wikipedia, excellent customer service. Now, is this a Wikipedia era or another case of some guys have all the luck? Like, what's the chance that a guy who lives in Portland, Oregon and makes a lot of money from Dark Horse Comics also spends time landscaping in Amherst, New York? I'll tell you what, I think the chances of both creating a memorable comic book character and a seven-figure landscaping company are pretty slim. Now, I'd be happy with either of those things, yet I have neither. So I'm just going to tell you right now, I don't believe for a minute that he owns a landscaping company. So there, I've said it. Now back to The Mask. The Mask has had several incarnations in the comics. In all versions, the story initially revolves around a magical mask which gives any wearer limitless power and an altered appearance, characterized by a large set of teeth and a green head. The mask affects the personality of the wearer by removing all personal social inhibitions, causing the wearer to become insane. Take note, the mask doesn't simply make people wacky or goofy, it makes them genuinely insane. Now, Richardson credits a number of inspirations, including the Joker and Steve Ditko's Creeper, as well as Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. In the original comic stories, characters who wore the mask would become dangerous and cruel anti-heroes at best, or villains at worst, with ultra-violent tendencies. And it's probably worthwhile to note that the movie was originally pitched as a horror movie, and that the director is known from Nightmare on Elm Street 3. I think it's not too much of a leap to see how The Mask could be a latter-day Freddy Krueger type of character. Now, the title of the comic book originally referred to the mask itself and not the character it unleashed. In early stories, the character was referred to as Big Head, not to be confused with that Todd guy in the rock band. But it was not until films and the television series that the character became known as The Mask. It is also important to note that one hallmark of The Mask comics has been graphic violence. It all starts in an antique shop where a neurotic man named Stanley Ipkiss shops for a gift to give his girlfriend Kathy. At the store, he purchases an old jade mask, which begins to speak to him. When Stanley wears it, he is transformed into a wacky, superpowered being with an abnormally large, bald, green-skinned head and a mouthful of large teeth. After exploring his new abilities, Ipkiss goes on a rampage, taking revenge on those with whom he has had a grudge, and earns the nickname Big Head. He becomes verbally abusive toward Kathy. She kicks him out but keeps the mask since it was a gift. So later, Stan breaks into her apartment and steals it back just as the police arrive in response to a domestic violence call. Deciding his only way out is as Big Head, Stan puts the mask back on and kills 11 police officers during his escape. He returns home as Big Head and removes the mask only to be shot in the back and killed by his abused girlfriend, Kathy, who's put two and two together and figured out the identity of Big Head. So I think you can see the darker tone from the get-go. Now, Kathy takes the mask to Lieutenant Kellaway, who appears in this movie, and of course he puts on the mask and becomes an extremely violent vigilante Big Head. He encounters Walter, a behemoth-sized mob muscle man who never speaks, who has undertaken a vendetta against Big Head for killing his employers. Walter never shows pain and is the only one who seems to be able to injure Big Head to any real degree. At one point, Stanley's girlfriend dresses like a hooker to lure a new criminal incarnation of Big Head in just so she can take off his mask and kill him. And the mask hasn't been limited to Dark Horse Comics either. In 2000, the Joker got his hands on the mask, and it was every bit as bad as one would think. And in 1997, Lobo was hired to find the ultimate bastich, which turned out to be the mask. At one point, Stanley returns from the dead as a zombie Big Head, but then the popularity of the mask as a Looney Tunes-type character led to what I would call a slow demise to the comic book character. Oh, well. We'll always have Son of the Mask to honor its memory. Doesn't Jamie Kennedy have a way of leaving a skid mark? I mean, leaving a mark on all of his projects.
No, you were right the first time.
So, man, had either of you guys ever, like, perused any of the comics?
I did more than peruse. I was a huge fan of the mask in the 90s. Like, early 90s, 92, 93, around there. Because I don't know how much you guys were involved in comics at that point, but the mask was a big deal. The comic book was huge. And, you know, it was kind of like the new Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles it was getting touted as. And it was great. Like, I really liked it. Being an angry, you know, teen,
yeah.
This was perfect. And so it was angry and funny and weird, and there were a lot of, like, non sequitur jokes, and, you know, having the main character be sort of a hero, kind of, and then you have the bad guy, I forget his name already. You just
Walter?
Mentioned him. Walter. Yeah. Having Walter in it, and the mask doesn't work on Walter because Walter tried to take it and put it on and it didn't work. And that was a big deal, too. Like, it was a really cool character for a time where everything was extreme. And this was also one of those things. And so it was great. So I am very, very familiar with the property.
And then were you, like me, kind of confused when you saw it was going to become a Saturday morning cartoon show? Like, not since Rambo and RoboCop became Saturday morning cartoon shows, have I felt that something was so inappropriate for a cartoon.
I was all about that RoboCop cartoon.
But at the time, by the time that the cartoon came out, because you knew it was going to be based on the movie, like that's where it was headed. You know, like, they weren't going to make a cartoon based on the comic books. That just was never going to happen.
Now, I will admit that I didn't see the movie in the theater. And part of what I thought appealed about the mask is I felt like in the comics, it sort of showed what the real results would be from cartoon violence. I mean, guts splattered everywhere, heads exploding. It was just sort of this odd juxtaposition of graphic, disgusting violence with slapstick. And when I heard they were making a movie, I didn't know what to expect, but I really didn't think they were just going to turn him into Bugs Bunny.
Well, that's what they did. I mean, you know, it's kind of like a Roger Rabbit light kind of thing.
Yeah, only I would say Roger, you know, in my opinion, I think Roger Rabbit did it a whole lot better.
And oh, yeah, without a doubt.
Cartoon characters. But this movie made a ton of money off not that big of a budget. I was surprised. Yeah. I saw the budget was like maybe 23, 28 million, somewhere in that range.
Yep.
For an effects heavy movie, man. That's a, seems to me like a small budget. I know Jim Carrey only got paid 450 grand to make the movie, and I think it pulled in like 300 million plus at the box office.
351.6 worldwide.
He made that back later.
Yeah.
Two films later, yeah, he was making 20 mil a picture. So
you know, it was a no-brainer that the sequel was going to be a big hit too, I guess.
I knew you were going to bring that up. The thing about this movie too is that it's, you know, I said this off show earlier, but this is Jim Carrey at his height. You know, he has those three movies in a row where he's just a massive, like he's going to be the biggest star in the world, and there's no doubt about it. After he goes Pet Detective to The Mask to Dumb and Dumber, and those three movies, you know, The Mask has not fared well over the years, but Dumb and Dumber certainly has, and to a lesser extent, so has Ace Ventura. I think more people name check the sequel more than the original now, but it was during a time where it was like, this guy is almost magic. And when it comes to casting Jim Carrey as The Mask, they really saved a lot on special effects because Jim Carrey's face and body does things no other human being's body does at that time.
Yeah.
And keep in mind that the line was a little bit blurred right there, like during this movie specifically, of where is the computer graphics and where is Jim Carrey? I mean, now you can see the line clear as day, but at that time you really couldn't. I couldn't.
And, you know, New Line Cinema also got a good deal because they got Jim Carrey to sign the contract and make this movie before the release of Ace Ventura. Ace Ventura, I think, was released in February. This movie was released in July of the same year. And if they had tried to get him to sign that contract, I think after Ace Ventura, his salary is going to, what, go up by at least four times? You know, it's going to be in the $2 million range.
There would be a lot more zeros for sure.
Yeah, I mean, when you've got like all three of these films out in 94. So, I mean, if that tells you anything, crazy. 1994 crazy, is the year of Carrey.
This guy was the number one box office draw in the 90s, man. I mean, there's just no two ways about it. And I was never a huge fan. I mean, I never disliked him. I just found him mildly amusing. I thought he worked better like, you know, I almost felt about him the way that sometimes you feel about SNL stars, even though he came from In Living Color instead of SNL. Like, they work better in smaller doses. That's why the skits work better than the movies. But he broke that trend, man. This guy made a lot of money at the box office.
Yes, he did.
And this movie introduced the world to Cameron Diaz.
Well, she had been in a couple of things before this, but this is definitely her breakout role.
Nope, this is it. She was.
Yeah, I thought this was her first role.
First one. Oh, yeah. She had like pretty much done modeling and stuff like that. You know, hey, when we look at some of the options that we had outside of this, they were thinking about possibly doing Anna Nicole Smith, who, you know,
So they chose well.
God bless her.
Yeah, they were. I mean, let's just call it what it is. They were looking for a Jessica Rabbit.
They were.
And they got Cameron Diaz.
Yes.
Vanessa Angel was another one that that was kind of looked at there. But I think they made a great choice. And I'll be honest with you. I think this is probably the best Cameron Diaz has probably ever looked.
I think I'd probably agree with you. And before this movie, I think she was famous for being a model who had a picture taken with a birdcage on her head. That was like a famous picture.
Who amongst us hasn't had a birdcage on her head after a fun night of, you know, carousing with the boys?
Yeah. And then she made this and then Charlie's Angels and never looked back, right?
Yeah. Some of us want to look back on Charlie Angels and go, really? But
now, how did you guys remember this movie going into it? Did you remember mostly positive, mostly lukewarm, or cold?
Adam, you should go first on this one because I'll have a lot to say.
Okay, so in 1994, Adam was 12 years old, right? So I am in the prime spot here. I saw Jim Carrey in Living Color, and then when he came to the movies with Ace Ventura, and then that was huge. Then The Mask comes up, and it's just like, oh my gosh, this is insane. And this thing was over the top. It was super colorful and kind of comic booky. I didn't know it was based on a comic per se, so I had no reference as far as that goes. But I was aware, you know, that was kind of comic-esque and whatnot. And a lot of it kind of went to my sensibilities. I'm a big fan of animation, Looney Tunes, you know, all that kind of good stuff. So a lot of this kind of, it spoke to me, and it was this was a time when I was just like, man, Jim Carrey can do no wrong, and this is over the top Jim Carrey if there was ever over the top Jim Carrey. And I really enjoyed it a whole lot, to where I know I probably watched this thing from probably age 12 to 14 a dozen plus times easily. To where while watching back this time again, I was shocked at how many like lines I knew like verbatim.
So I'm going to say you remembered it well then.
Like I remember
you had positive memories.
Yeah, I had not seen it in a while. I'll be honest with you. I had decent memories of it. I did not think those expectations, though, you know how memory gets colored, of course. I was definitely prepared for this to be absolutely horrible, though.
Well, man, this is the first time I've watched it beginning to end. Now, I think I've already said, I thought Jim Carrey was fine. I wasn't a massive fan. I watched Ace Ventura, and I thought, yeah, that movie's kind of funny. And everybody saw Ace Ventura, and everybody thought it was kind of funny. And it was one of those things where everybody found it entertaining, but nobody thought it was the funniest movie they ever saw. But because so many people saw it and had such a big box office, that it was approached as if it were maybe one of the greatest comedies ever made. And it's just like one of those weird things where everybody kind of liked it. So everybody went to see it and made a bunch of money, and it was rewatchable. But I don't know that anybody ever thought it was the greatest. And I was kind of, you know, maybe a little too strongly tied to the comics, and I didn't want to go see this movie. I've seen it, you know, over the years in bits and pieces. And I'll say that it for me, it looked better watching it just a little segment at a time than sitting through the whole thing.
And remember, despite the small budget, this movie was an effects extravaganza. I mean, it was huge, and that was also one of the big reasons that people went to see it, was because what they were doing with CGI was absolutely unheard of at the time.
And it got an Oscar nomination for effects.
And for good reason. It really should, because while it's not as good for 94, this CGI holds up fairly well, I'd say.
Yeah, I think so. I think it holds up
for
just
94,
fine.
Man, for, you know, for that long ago at this point.
And but you know, I will say that I don't know, man. This is something that I should love, you know, and I liked it fine enough in like little segments and small bits and stuff. But just as the whole deal, it didn't hold up like what I thought it would. Like, I still enjoy Dumb and Dumber quite a bit. This one, I don't seem to as much.
Kanan, what do you think?
Well, here, I want to bring this point up first before I begin my screed. Watching this movie last night, I've come to realize that the character of Deadpool, what Deadpool has turned into, it owes a whole lot to this movie.
Wow, I did not think of that, but you were dead on.
Yeah, you know, all of the clever side bits that are in this movie, Deadpool, the writers of Deadpool, when they turned him from, you know, the character he originally was with Liefeld to what he became, this is what this is. You know, it's the same thing. It's just, you know, it's 94.
But I'd say it kept closer to the comics, though, because they kept the violence intact with Deadpool.
Well, but I don't mean the movie itself. I just mean the character, you know, the source material of the comic books. A lot of this, a lot was taken from this. So I could see someone watching this movie now and going, well, Deadpool does this all better. Well, yeah, he does, because he Deadpool doesn't exist the way he is now without this movie, in my opinion. So let me start from the beginning, right? So 1994, I am not 12 years old. In 1994, I am a fully functioning adult.
don't go making too big of a declaration there. You were an adult. We'll leave the functioning out of it.
Yeah, you are correct. I didn't become a fully functioning till I was about 32. You're right. So but here's the thing, right? Is that I see this movie in the movie theater. I love the comic books, because at this point there are three miniseries that come out for The Mask. It's The Mask, it's Return of the Mask, and it's Walter. All of these come out just before this movie comes out. I love The Mask. I love it, love it. And I, while I don't love Jim Carrey, I think Jim Carrey is great. Because at this point, also, I'm a struggling, terrible stand-up comic, like open mic comic at this point. And so, you know, seeing a physical comedian like this, we hadn't seen a physical comedian like Jim Carrey in probably 25 years. I mean, you know, I'm thinking of someone like the Jack Tripper character on Three's Company. Like, it's been a very long time at this point since we've seen someone who's this physical with their comedy. And so I am so excited to see The Mask. I can't wait to see it. I see it in the movie theater. And because I am such an angry, you know, 20-year-old guy, I hate this movie with a blinding passion. I hate everything about it. I think that the acting is terrible, although I think Jim Carrey in it is great. Jim Carrey was awesome in it. And I also thought that Cameron Diaz was just a great-looking lady because, you know, I'm a red-blooded American male who happens to be straight. All straight men are going to think Cameron Diaz in this movie is beautiful. It's just the way that goes, right? But other than that, this movie, I hated it so much that I was like, I'm never seeing this movie again. And then we have our podcast, and then it comes back up again. So I was fully, fully ready to absolutely hate this movie. But here's the thing. I am no longer an angry 20-year-old failed comic. I am now much older than that. And I can see this movie for what it is. And I like this movie now. But let me change that. I like the first two acts of this movie. The first two acts of this movie are very strong and very good. The second that the bad guy puts the mask on, this thing falls apart. But the first two acts of this movie are really great. And Jim Carrey specifically, watching him now and knowing who he is now versus who he was then, before he went nuts and, you know, took himself way too seriously and he's so self-important. Back then, he was none of those things, or at least he wasn't publicly any of those things. And so seeing him in these movies and he's having so much fun as this character and seeing just what he brings to this movie. You don't make this movie without Jim Carrey. There isn't a single person I can think of in 30 years who could do this role. It's just Jim Carrey. And so the first two acts of this movie, and the other part to this too, and I totally forget about this with Carrey, is that he plays put on nice guy so well, like Ben Stiller level, like good guy who's always getting crapped on, mm-hmm. and Carrey does that so well in this movie that it was enjoyable to watch. I really enjoyed watching the first two acts of this movie. And it surprised me because I was so angry towards this movie when it first came out. And so it was like almost like a nice treat that, oh, hey, like this movie doesn't suck as bad as I thought it would.
Now, do we have anybody now that's like even close to a Jim Carrey type? Like, what I mean is, if somebody wanted to make the Jim Carrey biopic in 2019, who would they cast to play Jim Carrey?
Well, they would make the mistake of making it someone who's funny and good looking. They would make that mistake. So who they would pick first is Ryan Reynolds. That's wrong. That is not the character that is not the actor you pick for this. You basically have to pick someone who is a incredibly gifted physical comedian who is young enough to be able to play Jim Carrey in his early 20s, but also someone who can, you know, has their own spin on all of this.
And they also have to have that slight bit of personality trait where they're oblivious to just how obnoxious they are. Because, I mean, you have to be able to push way beyond the realms of tolerability to be Jim Carrey. Like, it works when you get past a certain point, but you don't get past that point if you have any kind of like self-awareness of how annoying you are to others. You know, you understand what I'm saying? I'm not trying to
completely.
Be negative there, but you have to be
completely
missing a certain type of filter to get anywhere close to where he is.
I don't know what you're talking about.
but you know, there are plenty of hacky people that try to do what Jim Carrey does and they just don't. And I'll be honest, I suspect that for a long time, Jim Carrey couldn't do what he does. I think that it took a lot of pounding away to get to the level that he's at when we're seeing this movie and Dumb and Dumber. And I'll dare say that I think cocaine may have played a role somewhere along the way.
Oh, you think?
Yeah. That seems to be the perfect thing to disinhibit it. I think Christian Bale would play Jim Carrey in the biopic.
Well, unfortunately, Christian Bale is like maybe 3 years younger than Jim Carrey. I don't know who that person is, but as I said earlier, it had been 30 years before we had seen someone like Jim Carrey. I mean, you know, this person doesn't really exist in mainstream media anymore.
There was a real sweet spot in the early 90s, too, because I think it's fair to say Chris Farley and Jim Carrey were contemporaries, and they both did sort of like the same thing with very different body types.
Yes, I agree with that. You know, I think that at this point now, you would have to go with someone basically from Cirque du Soleil or, you know, like one of those like the Ringling Brothers had that super strong clown who was skinny. Like that's basically where you would have to go to find someone even to remotely touch his work at this point.
I'm casting maybe that Tony Jim Robbins picture. Guy.
Is he still around, Tony Robbins?
Tony Robbins is like 60 years old.
Give me that skinny clown boy.
Well, he already has the teeth.
Yeah.
the issue here is that while I watch this movie and the dance numbers are amazing and it's surprising the level of accuracy with which Jim Carrey can transform himself. And we hadn't seen and we've seen it, you know, since then, because one of my family's favorite movies is a series of unfortunate events where he plays a bunch of different characters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he's so great in that movie. And he's great in this, too. At issue here, though, with the mask is that even though Jim Carrey is so, so good in it, is the movie good?
And also, man, I'm just going to say that what Jim Carrey does can be exhausting watching it for an hour and a half.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's just too much. I mean, there's a reason that Bugs Bunny cartoons were like 10 minutes long at the most. I mean, Duck Season, Rabbit Season is probably sub 10 minutes. And it's just because that level of intensity with goofiness gets real old real quick. You can't help but repeat the same jokes. I mean, every time he takes off running, like the first time he did it, it was funny. The second time it was like a callback. And then by the 12th time that he does the cartoon takeoff for his run, I'm over it.
Yeah, agreed. But then you also have things like the Cuban Pete dance sequence, which is terrific. It's really so good.
Huh.
And you know, like and it's funny, and there's jokes within the dance sequence that every time he shakes his butt, it makes that maraca noise. Like, that is...
Yeah, the thing is, I'd already seen Beetlejuice, you know, so it didn't maybe hit me with the impact that it should have.
Well, it feels like that was a setup for me, Bruce, and I don't appreciate it.
I'm sorry. But anyway, was New Line affiliated with Warner Brothers in any form in 1994?
No.
Not at this time.
No.
Because, man, they really play up the Looney Tunes. Like, they're trying to explain why the mask acts the way he does by showing us that Stanley, you know, we get him watching some Tex Avery cartoons or something there at the beginning.
Right.
He's got the Tasmanian devil throw pillow on his couch. And, you know, knowing that the mask did later cross over with some DC Comics characters, I just kind of wondered why all the Warner Brothers love here. They're really setting us up for a live action Looney Tune here.
Well, that's what they've got to do. I mean,
yeah.
It, without that, it doesn't make a whole hell of a lot of sense. You're just like, I guess he's a thing. I don't know. It totally makes sense to lay those tracks.
Yeah, there's also the idea that maybe the mask makes you insane. You don't have to throw all the Looney Tunes in there. But, you know, nice, I guess, for Looney Tunes fans.
Here's the thing. We're playing to Carrey's strengths here. And that's, you know, they realize, hey, here's who we've got, and here's what his strengths are. We're going to change this thing, you know, to lean on those strengths because that's what he's good at.
And isn't 1994 like that brief period where all the dude bros were getting Tasmanian devil tattoos? Like, I'm pretty sure that didn't happen before or after.
It was a little bit before then. It was a touch before then. Like, Tasmanian devil was probably, I'd have to look this up. But I'm going to say probably in the more 91 to 92-ish range.
So that's my challenge to the listeners. Find someone with a Tasmanian devil tattoo on their calf or their shoulder blade and ask them what year they got it.
Well, I can tell you that it was at the very least 92.
91, 92. I'm doing the math.
I was a freshman in college, and no less than three dudes had Tasmanian devil tattoos.
Oh, I thought you were going to tell us about yours, Sean.
I have no tattoos. He's like, tattoos I've are got stupid.
Mine. I was the weird guy that opted for Tweety Bird. Nobody got it.
See, I got Slowpoke Rodriguez because no one will have it.
Señor. I love that character.
He carries
so
a big
much.
Gun. That's all you need to know.
Oh my gosh, it's so funny. Get him Slowpoke.
Well, man, let's talk about the first transformation, because a whole lot of this before the transformation, we're just sitting there waiting for him to put the mask on, right? I mean, nobody really cares about the first act of this movie, dude.
Here's the thing, though, man. Well,
I'm sorry, Adam. Go ahead. You pontificate.
But. And Sean like talked about this a little bit. Jim Carrey is a, and we knew this certainly afterward when he got into more, you know, things Truman Show, especially like Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. Jim Carrey can really act. The guy is a great actor. And when you look back at this stuff, and as crazy and as over the top as he is in all of the, you know, the mask stuff, his Stanley stuff is super underplayed and done really, really well. And I don't think, you know, in watching this, many people are going to give him the credit for the Stanley bits that he actually deserves.
Okay, so this is a question with only one right answer, Adam. What was Jim Carrey's best role ever, his best performance?
Eternal Sunshine.
Yeah. Oh, you got the wrong answer. The wrong answer.
No, he's got the right one.
It's definitely Colonel Stars and Stripes and Kick-Ass 2. I'll stand by that.
I love that character. I love that character, but... That character ain't making it like its own spinoff movie.
Well, I can't wait to review that movie so I can point out how you're both wrong about that. But anyway,
we have reviewed that movie.
Yeah,
we did part one, not part two.
We did part two, but not part one.
We did.
Oh man, I'm all backwards. Then are you sure we did part two?
I know we did.
We
part
absolutely
two.
Did.
Yeah. Let's do it again. Because that's favorite performance.
We gushed about Jim Carrey in it.
When we get to $2,000 a month on Patreon, we'll do it again. We're a long way away. So.
Oh man, you're trying to make me write that check, aren't you?
Boy, if you were the one who did it, that would be hilarious. It'd be like, show me how much you care.
There's some Ben Stein fans that probably like the first act of this movie too.
Ben Stein, he shows up on the come day. On, when Ben Stein comes on, we all cheer. You know it, I know it, we all know it.
Well, man. Once he puts on the zoot suit and he goes to the Coco Bongo, I guess is Edge City supposed to be like some weird amalgamation of New York and Miami? Because there are times where it really seems New York and times it really sees Miami. But he goes to Coco Bongo, and I'll tell you, man, movies love this, especially superhero movies. I know we've seen it at least one other time, if not more. But, you know, all my life growing up, I imagined that if I ever went to like jazz clubs or what do you call this, a Babaloo club? What's the kind of music that they play here? Merengue? I don't know my music terms that well. Cuban jazz? Anyway, I always imagined that there would be a time when I was cool and a real hep daddy going to one of these cool cat clubs where just random strangers would get up out of the crowd and do a big song and dance number that just knocked everybody's socks off. But I got to tell you, that doesn't happen much in real life.
I feel like it's got to have happened somewhere, right?
I feel like the bouncer wouldn't let you get through more than maybe eight words before you got taken off the stage.
Now I'm not saying that you get on stage and start, you know, going away. That you'll probably get jumped. But on account of like just big giant dance numbers going on, I gotta think that happened somewhere.
Oh, man. All that I know is we're just one trip from Miami and me buying enough drinks for Adam away from seeing what will happen.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
Go up there and do your Ricky Ricardo song, Adam.
You bet I will. I'll do both Ricky and Lucy.
The only one I know is that old Ricky, You're So Fine song.
I think that's another one.
Yeah. But, man, I've always thought that I would see way more impromptu members of the audience jumping up and stealing the show than I've seen in my adult life.
You're just not living life enough to the edge. What can I say?
So let's talk about that scene. Right. So when he gets in the zoot suit and the dancing starts happening, I have to say that I was thoroughly entertained with just how much, and I mean, they're not doing all the dancing, clearly, but just how much dancing Jim Carrey is doing in this. There's a lot of him dancing in this scene. You know, when they start doing the really, really big swing dance stuff, that it's not him. But for the most part, I would say 70% of the dancing is him in this scene.
There's a good bit. You can tell. Yeah.
And it's great.
Watching this movie did also remind me that I used to be a great dancer. I got to break out my old shiny shoes again.
I have to tell you, I don't know if you're being serious right now.
Oh, man, I used to be a great dancer. I got to work on that. You guys, I'll knock your socks off at Dragon Con next year.
Come on, think about this, though. What, could you not see Bruce in some sort of a zoot suit sort of thing, hat with the feather in it and an oversized coat? Come on, this is right up his alley.
Man, we've already established I'd be dressed in a clown suit like Rerun.
I still want that to happen, too.
And if I have to, I can break into a little Gene dancing machine, too.
Oh, all the dreams are coming true today.
But my high kicks were astonishing when I was younger.
I used to could do a high kick, like a real good like karate high kick. Yeah, you don't do that a lot in your 30s.
Yeah, now I would tear something I wouldn't want to have stitched back up.
Not a lot of need for the roundhouse kicks in your 30s.
But we do get, I don't know, we get like the awesomeness of the cartoon violence. We get to see his invulnerability here.
Oh, right, because they start shooting at him, yeah. And they do the very cartoony, you know, his body turns into a noodle and all that stuff. It's interesting to me, the other thing about the scene is that you see just how, like, his presence, that it's not something where you it's not far-flung and not out of the realm of possibility that Jim Carrey could walk into a dance club and take it over. Like, I could totally see that in this scene. Whereas, Cameron Diaz, while gorgeous, I don't know if she would be doing the same thing.
Well, she certainly didn't sing in this thing, so that's not her thing.
And though he's always wonderful, young Reggie Cathy is not the Reggie Cathy that I know and love today.
No, he definitely has taken his voice to new levels.
He smoked several cartons of unfiltered Camels between this movie and what I know now.
He got to the unfiltered yet. He's been doing filters like a little girl up until this point, and then he's just like, you know what? I need to step it up and be a man.
But I love it that he's a bank robber that calls himself the doctor or the surgeon or something like that. And then, of course, his big robbery gets foiled by a cartoon character who Tasmanian devils in and out of the bank with money bags that actually have the dollar signs painted on them.
I love that their first go-to is just like, the police are coming. Well, unload.
Oh, man. And I also like it, the very tasteful limousine that the mask chooses when he shows up at the club, man, with the horns on the front that do sound like something out of a Looney Tunes horn honk.
Love it. Well, extra long limos.
It's the General Lee, isn't it? It's the General Lee sound.
I thought it was maybe less offensive than that. I don't remember now. I thought it had more of an ooga to it or something, but I'll have to go check it out again.
Oh, it might.
I thought it had more of a swing beat to it or something. But I do like, you know, he fans out the, it seems like almost a Jim Carrey improvised thing when he fans out the money and says, maybe you've got my friends on your list, Benjamin Franklin, Abraham Lincoln and Andrew Jackson or something like that, when he's got the dollars all fanned out there. That I would have loved it if they were all $2 bills, though.
So when we get to this scene, is this the first big number in this movie?
No, because he had already done the big number, and then when he was going back, he realized he needed some bread or needed some cash to do it. I thought that he had already had the big number once before, but I could be off on that. I thought this was his second suit, his second appearance.
Is it? No, because you got it all wrong. No, because he goes to he tries to get into the club, can't. Then he goes home, or he finds the mask because his car breaks down on the bridge, and then the next night he goes out. Right.
Okay. But so this is the second time he's donned the mask, though, because he put it on the first time, I guess, and just roughed up a bunch of alleyway hooligans.
Which, by the way, there's some stuff in here that I was just like, oh, 12-year-old Adam didn't recognize some of these jokes as a child. One of them was the old happened during the balloon trick. I was just like, oh, well, I certainly didn't realize what that was back when I was a child. I'm like, oh.
But because before he goes to the nightclub, he's already been interviewed by the newspaper reporter, Peggy Brandt, wanted to ask him if he knows anything about this mask that they heard about the previous night.
Right.
So this is his second outing.
But there's no big dance number.
Like, okay. So, I mean, he so he this does, is it where he's doing the wolf face and howling and everything. That's all here. Okay. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, because gotcha. he attacks his landlady, who's terrible, and then he goes after the car guys.
Oh, that's right, because he says something about lug nuts or something like that. I remember
hold
that.
Hold on
now.
To your lug nuts.
That's right, and he's armed with mufflers for some reason.
Yes, well, because we know what he's going to do with those mufflers.
He's going to muffle them.
And it's time for an overhaul.
And one of my favorite moments in this movie, even from back then, was when they're bringing those guys out on the gurney, and the one guy goes, "Be careful of the bump! Be careful of the bump!"
Now, the guy, sort of the bad guy. I mean, like the main bad guy, the Nico guy that wants, you know, the underboss wants to overthrow the big boss.
Right.
Is that Peter Green? Is that the actor's name playing underboss?
Orestes Mentesina.
Well, that's the main. That's the main bad guy.
Oh, wait, that's the other
he's
guy.
Talking about.
Oh, you're talking about
the. Because well, man, Peter Green is good at this role. If that's the actor's name.
So you
name.
Said Nico? That's Dorian.
Name. That's what now?
Dorian is the one you're thinking of.
Dorian Tyrell, yeah.
Yeah, that's the other guy. That's the Peter.
Yeah, but I love that actor, man. He's good in these kind of roles. I feel like we've seen him at least 7 times.
Yeah, doing this same role.
Yeah.
Whenever they can't get Robert Davi, they got him.
You got your Robert Davis, you got your Peter Greens, and there's one other cat that's just like this. I forget his name, but there's a couple of guys that all have this
Five-ish
sort of look.
Finkel.
Five-ish Finkel, of course. But he was Zed in Pulp Fiction. I think that's where a lot of people probably know him from.
Yeah.
As well.
Zed's dead, baby.
Mm-hmm.
It isn't a chopper. It's not a motorcycle, baby. It's a chopper.
Yeah. Oh, man. But then after the whole thing, I like it that somehow they get a piece of his pajamas in all this. Like, he transforms back, but a piece of his pajamas get left at the scene. And that's how the lieutenant of the police department gets on his trail, as well as the criminals.
I thought that
and
was
he goes
cool.
to see Ben Stein.
Well, let's talk about the captain of police here.
Yeah.
Because I absolutely love him. And there's something that only Peter Reigart can say and have it be a great line, and it's just him with no, those pajamas are impossible. This actually happened. Like, that's such a very Peter Reigart like way to say that line. And it reminds me of like, why doesn't that guy work more? You know, he everybody loved him in Animal House, and then he just kind of had more roles like this one. You know, like he didn't get like a gigantic movie after Animal House, and I wonder why.
And then, being a comic fan, you had to hope that maybe in the sequel he gets the mask, right?
That would be awesome. Yeah, although it's the cop, and then it just goes to random people after that. Am I right? Am I remembering that right?
Yeah, kind of, but the cop is the one that gets to have the big story arc with Walter.
Right, right. Oh, man, not having Walter in this movie totally could have used Walter.
See, they were saving him for the sequel, but he didn't manage to make it.
But I do love him shouting Doyle, like, every time. Like, that's
Doyle?
Just, that great, that just old-fashioned great, I love it.
But what do you think of the sit-down that Jim Carrey has with Ben Stein?
Well,
I mean, talk about more opposite personalities in a room together. It's something just interesting to stare at, if nothing else. Like the shtick that's made Ben Stein famous versus what Jim Carrey's so well known for.
It's true. You know, it's a fine scene. I don't think that you even need Ben Stein for this role. It's great that he's in it because he adds to it for sure. But you don't need him in it.
Ben Stein's only been needed for one role ever. I mean, let's be honest.
Yes.
I'm not a huge Ben Stein fan.
When Ben Stein's money, because if you take him out of it, the phrase "when Ben Stein's money" makes no flipping sense.
Well, as long as he's there going Bueller, 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 that's the only role I ever needed him for in my life.
Very true.
But I don't know. Did they explain satisfactorily why the mask didn't work in Ben Stein's office?
Because it was a night mask. they don't explain it to you with words. They explain it to you through action, which is the right way to do it, where it has to be nighttime in order for it to work.
No, he pontificates.
He
that
says
in the office,
that. Yeah, he
oh,
says
you're
that.
Right, you're right.
But I don't know if I like that explanation or not, man. I don't know that I like a mask that only works at night.
I thought it was a great way to get around, you know, just a little plot thing where it's just like, it's the thank you for smoking. How do we do the thing? Just write a line that says that's the thing, and there you go.
Yeah, agree.
I think I would have liked it better if he, like, didn't want to take it off and then the sun rose and it just fell off or something. Because, I mean, who would ever want to take this off once you put it on? Because it makes you nuts in the first place. So your logical brain isn't going to be working very well. I can't picture anybody taking it off voluntarily.
It's got to be hot under there, like, though. It's got to be hot.
It's like the world's wackiest Venom.
which is shooting right now.
That'd be great if that's what the title is, World's Wackiest Venom, when it comes out.
Let that sink in. They're shooting a Venom movie right now, guys. Oh, boy.
Now, what did you guys think about this whole... I don't know if it's a dichotomy. I feel like that somewhere there's a script that's trying to give us more of a triangle than we get in this movie. But the whole idea that Tina likes the mask, but the red-haired reporter actually likes Stanley. And you feel like at some point he should have to decide between the two of them or something. But I feel like that kind of gets lost somewhere in this movie. And also knowing that the red-haired reporter died in the original cut of this movie and they made it so she would live for a potential sequel gives away that there's supposed to be some gravity to that I don't think gets communicated real well.
Oh, wow. That's surprising. I didn't know that. So John, I can't remember the actor's name of the guy who played Jack Tripper.
John Ritter?
John Ritter's, because that's John Ritter's wife in that role.
Oh, and, very cool, man.
Yeah. And so that's surprising that they were going to make her bigger, better. I did not know that.
And we haven't really, I mean, she does double cross him at the end, though. So right. I think that maybe undercuts the love story, but it's totally like messed up because most movies, it's the person who likes Stanley that should come out on top and not the person who likes the mask, you know?
Mm-hmm. For sure. But what a nice flip for a change.
If unintentional.
But to me, this movie completely falls apart starting the third act. It's where everything goes to crap because I was really enjoying it, quite honestly, and like, oh, what a nice thing to find, and then you know he gets arrested, and then the bad guy gets the mask, and you get the stupid look of the bad guy wearing the mask. It's a terrible, terrible costume.
And the bad guy just can't pull it off either. He's not really doing it. The only thing the mask seems to do to him is make him uglier. Like, he doesn't seem to have any of the cartoon powers that Stanley has when he's wearing the mask.
Right. Well, the only time you ever see anything even remotely like that is when he gets shot with all the bullets and then he pulls all the bullets into himself and uses his mouth as a gun.
Yeah.
Which is stupid. And very, very lame, and then it becomes sort of like a revenge fantasy movie by the end, where like I gotta save the girl, and it's all your tropes, and it just completely and utterly falls apart there. But up until that point, it was a fun, weird movie, and I was really enjoying it up until then.
And I guess both of you guys are big on the Cuban Pete scene.
It's a lot of fun.
It's so fun.
Yeah, I don't know, though, if a movie being made in 2017 has a song called Cuban Pete in it. I think they have to find another song.
He's from Cuba. What do you want from him?
I think if you have a character like The Mask or like Deadpool, you're going to have Cuban Pete in there.
Yeah, I mean, okay. Honestly, take the role, put it as Deadpool, tell me they don't do Cuban Pete.
You know what? You're probably right. You're probably right.
They 100% they would do that. And it would be hilarious there, too.
It would. I would laugh.
Why not, man?
But, yeah, look, you're right. The third act is kind of the weakest part of the whole thing. But, I mean,
but that's when the dog gets to put the mask on. Isn't that supposed to be full of laughs?
First of all, I don't like the dog with the mask, but I get it. It's kind of fun. But at the same time, though, like the whole getting him out of jail stuff with the dog, I had a Jack Russell Terrier for a while. I loved little dogs. And trust me, those are smart little dogs, too. I don't know. It's just fun.
Is that the same dog from Frasier?
Uh-huh.
Like, he gets around, man. He's a hardworking dog.
Mm-hmm. I know it's the same dog as Wishbone.
Listen, who are we talking to, Bruce? We got to, you know.
Would this movie make the cut for, the sequel should have just been the dog in the mask. Then it could have
I totally agree.
Then we would have had something working here. The Max is the name of the dog, just so you know. He has an IMDb page, by the way.
He prefers to go by his full name, Maximilian.
He was also in a movie called Mr. Accident. He's only done two roles, the Mr. Accident and the Mask.
Of course, if they made the movie today, they'd have to get that dog from WrestleMania because he's really good.
That is a good dog.
Oh, but guess what? Mr. Accident, a Yahoo Serious film.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, man. Imagine Yahoo Serious is the Mask.
Directed and starring.
I hope that guy's all right.
He's still the third highest paid actor in Australia, so he's doing fine.
Email us, Mr. Serious. We're worried about you.
He's right behind Paul Hogan and Hugh Jackman.
Just
in that order, strangely.
Just barely.
I was going to say, in that order?
anything else we want to kind of touch
no,
on?
No, man. I said everything I'm going to say.
I mean, Cameron Diaz, I guess, throws the mask away, but then, of course, he has to go after it. Milo swims away with the mask, so you know. They're setting us up perfectly for a dog-based mask movie in the sequel that we don't quite get.
Yeah. Would have been perfect.
And I guess we haven't really talked about Richard Jenny, much to say about the dim-witted best friend role.
Rest in peace, Richard Jenny. Always a hilarious guy. That I don't think, you know, kids today will know who that is.
I like Richard Jenny.
I liked Richard Jenny just fine. I thought he was a good comedian and just fine in this role.
Yeah, I mean there's nothing to really write home about in this role.
No.
But what are you gonna do?
No,
your second banana to Jim Carrey, for heaven's sake, who I'm sure Jenny probably hated at the time. Just like this guy, this is the guy who you get. I've been doing stand up for 48 years at this point.
In a strange turn of events, they thought they were getting Richard Belzer till Jenny showed up.
Oh, what in the mask starring Richard Belzer?
He's playing Munch.
Oh, man.
All right. Before we get down to our final notes here and everything, we have to ask ourselves a question. How does this movie relate to Sylvester Stallone?
Why, thank you, Adam. I have a prepared statement. Ooh. Anne Fletcher is this week's Stallone connection. She's credited as dancer for 1994's The Mask, a movie that has a whole lot of dancing in it. Far more dancing than most people realize. There's more dancing in The Mask than there is in Dirty Dancing 2 Havana Nights. I don't actually know if it does because I've never seen Dirty Dancing 2 Havana Nights because why? Why? Why would you watch Dirty Dancing 2 Havana Nights? All the dancing that happens in The Mask isn't a bad thing. The dance numbers are bright spots. And who would have guessed that having a gifted physical comedian would be such a good dancer? And having someone like Anne Fletcher on the payroll just makes sense. But Anne Fletcher has worked on dancing-based movies like Step It Up, Bring It On, and Hairspray. She's also credited as Hot Tracks dancer on Boogie Nights, which I don't really have a vague understanding of what that job is. And without looking it up, I will make up what a hot tracks dancer does for you now. A hot tracks dancer is someone who used to dance on a short-lived TV show called Hot Tracks, which was a TV show like Solid Gold, except instead of being hosted by Dionne Warwick and Rex Smith, it was hosted by Byron Allen and the girl from Mr. Belvedere.
Yeah.
I don't know how close I got, but I bet it's pretty close. Because as I may have stated once or twice on this show before, I work in the business. Anyway, Anne Fletcher is your Stallone connection this week because she was also the assistant choreographer on the movie Ants, which was a full-length cartoon starring sex offender Woody Allen and a guy who has never had anything ever said or replied about him sexually, Sylvester Stallone. Anne Fletcher was born in Detroit, Michigan, and her nickname is Mama Fletcher. She's been working since 1994 when she worked on The Mask and the live-action Flintstones movie, which leads one to ask, who the hell was asking for a live-action Flintstones movie? She's listed as the director of the Reese Witherspoon vehicle Hot Pursuit, and she's got 7 movies in the works, but by far, my favorite credit for Mama Fletcher is when she was the choreographer for a short film in 2014 called Dragula, which on IMDb is described as a high school senior who overcomes his emotional dysfunction and self-esteem issues when he unwittingly meets Dragula. And if you think I'm not going to check this out to see what's going on with this thing, you clearly don't know anything about me. Dragula. It's called Dragula. It sounds like it has everything. So there you have it, HMPers, this week's Stallone connection. Now, Frank and Stanley, let's review The Mask so I can start prepping for my Star Wars review, which is only a few weeks away.
Yes, indeed. And here's the thing, man. This is why I want you guys to know that Keenan is the real deal over here, because there are actually so many people actually that are in this film that are related to Sylvester Stallone, and he did not do the easy work. No, sir. No, he did not.
No. No, I did not.
I just want to point that out to folks that may not go. Just go like, boy, he had to really dig deep on that. He didn't have to, but he did. But he
I know.
Did.
I thought for sure he was going to go with Max the dog from Rambo 4.
Could have been anything. So here on Hero Movie Podcast, we don't have letters. We don't have grades. We have our own little silly patented Robin rating system. Why don't you head on down to facebook.com/Hero Movie Podcast. It's right there at the top of the page. Drop us a like there while you're at it. Bruce, where does The Mask from 1994 fall in the Robin rating system for you, sir?
I was kind of surprised at how little I enjoyed this movie. I mean, I'm usually into corny humor and over-the-top acting with a little bit of camp. I mean, are you guys surprised I didn't like this movie more? I mean, you know that my bar is pretty low for the comedy I like.
Honestly,
I would actually.
Yeah, I would have put you in a much higher likitude of this.
Yeah, it just got old very quickly for me. And like I said before, there's a reason Bugs Bunny cartoons don't stretch beyond the 10-minute mark, because they get exhausting. Roger Rabbit did what I think they were going for here so much better. But some people are going to get a kick out of it, nostalgic or otherwise. So I'm going to give it a Damian Wayne.
Cool. And Bruce, I'm going to ask you this before I hand it over to Keenan. I'll ask him the same question. Favorite Looney Tune?
You mean like character or episode?
Character.
Oh, man. For me, it's definitely going to be Marvin the Martian.
That sounds about right from you. Sean?
I'll answer the Looney Tunes question first. I like the very polite chipmunks. They're my favorite.
Oh,
Looney Tunes characters. No, after you. No, I insist.
Oh, no.
Oh, okay.
That is a great one.
I love those characters.
Good deep pull.
I like that. In this movie, I surprisingly liked it more than I thought I would, because I really thought I was going to hate this movie. And so for me, it's a Damian Wayne as well. And it's surprising to me, because I really thought I was going to be doing nothing but complaining about this movie for the entire hour here.
Cool. Daffy Duck for me, because he's a giant, giant jerk to everyone all the time, and I find it hilarious. For me,
I always had you pegged as a Foghorn Leghorn.
Oh, that's a very close second. That's a very close second. something about a boy that don't know how to play baseball. I like this movie a lot. Like I said, I was surprised at how actually big time quotable it was for me. I probably watched this thing a boatload of times on VHS back in the day. It's overall, here's the thing that I've talked to a lot of people about. There are movies that are of a certain age and you saw during a certain age that will always kind of be clouded in, you know, something, right? You have to be able to step out and say, hey, look, that was the kid you love that movie, so it's probably not that great of a movie. This is probably one of those movies, but at the same time, too, this movie is very 1994. I think it does what it set out to do, and because of that, I gotta go Tim Drake on this one. I had a fun enough time. I thought I was gonna hate it. I thought, oh man, dumb kid Adam really loved this, so adult Adam's probably gonna think it's terrible. It's not bad. It's a decent time. I think it set out to do a particular thing, and it did that particular thing really well, actually. So I'd say give it a shot. Good on you people on Patreon. For picking this one out for us, man. And, of course, we'll have you do that coming up soon for the next month as well, man. So keep an eye out for that. Sean just went into a castle or something. I don't know what happened. In the meantime, next week, we'll talk about next week right here, because next week we're going to be doing something a little bit special. It's Christmas time, everybody. And we're going to be reviewing an episode of Batman the Animated Series entitled Christmas with the Joker. That's season one, episode two. So if you want to check that out, it's on Amazon Prime right now. All the Batman animated series is there. So not only watch that, watch a whole bunch of other ones, because that show is pretty darn good. And of course, we'll read some emails and other things of that nature. In the meantime, Bruce, where can we find more of your work on the internet, sir?
I'm still begging people to check out Nerdspawn Genesis. I'll say that it's the best superhero comedy novel you're going to find for only $2.99. It's on Amazon. It's enrolled in Kindle Unlimited so that Kindle Unlimited subscribers can read for free. It's also available as a paperback. And the audiobook, I think it's fair to say, is in pre-production. But help me out a smidge and check it out. If you've already checked it out, maybe you can leave a 5-star review.
You know what I'm doing? I'm buying a couple of the paperbacks and giving them out to people as gifts for the Christmas and everything. And I'm being like, here's your present, a book about me.
Perfect.
It's pretty genius. Keenan.
Makes a great white elephant gift.
you can find me on Twitter at Hero Movie Sean.
And out there on I-95, just thumbing a rod down the good old-fashioned highway. That's how we do it. And, of course, the film find at thefilmfind.com. Nerd Talk Now live. Just check out facebook.com/nerdtalknow. I'm going back and forth of where I'm doing that live show, so just check out for information there. That is it, everybody. Join us next week for our special Christmas episode when we talk a little bit of Batman, the animated series. For Sean Keenan and Bruce Leslie, I'm Adam Portrais. Stay super, everybody.
Bye, Marty and Evie.
They call me Cuban Pete. I'm the king of the rumba beat. When I play the maracas, I go chick, chicky, boom, chick, chicky, boom. Yes, sir, I'm Cuban Pete. I'm the craze of my native street. When I start to dance, everything goes chick, chicky, boom, chick, chicky, boom. The senoritas, they sing and they swing with their rompero. It's very nice, so full of fight. And when they're dancing, they bring a happy ring to that arquero. Singing a song all the day long. Now, if you like the beat, take a lesson from Cuban Pete. And I'll teach you to chick, chicky, boom, chick, chicky, boom, chick, chicky, boom. Senorita, I know that you would like a cheeky boom chick. It's very nice, so full of spice.
Place my hand on your hip, and if you will just give me your hand,
then we shall try, just you and I. If you like the beat, take a lazy room to the beat, and I'll teach you to chick chicky boom, chick chicky boom, chick chicky boom.
Hit that, jump, jump, shake your booty, daddy, wow, see ya!